the second closeout meeting for a WP project. Mark paved the way last week with the onboard president. The projects we did in Web Package E had a duration of anything between 24 and 30 months, and the projects that are finishing now are the ones that had only a 24-month duration. And you're one of those projects. The title of the project was STREAM, Strategic Trajectory Deconfliction to Enable Seamless Aircraft Conflict Management. We have six from the project team, two from ALG Indra, two from Boeing, and two from the University of Barcelona, and I think you're all going to share the presentation. The audience, you're fully authorized to ask difficult questions. With that, I'll hand over to Ruben.
Thank you very much for giving us the opportunity to present the outcomes, the results from the STREAM project. This is the first time we do a cross-out meeting regarding Web Package E projects on our side. So first, maybe, I don't know if it is necessary to do a quick presentation of the members of the team. On this side, Boeing representatives, so maybe you can present yourselves quickly.
So, Miguel. My name is Miguel La Plana from Boeing Research and Technology Europe in Madrid, responsible for traffic management research projects there.
My name is Javier López. I'm also working at Boeing Research and Technology in Madrid. I'm involved in developing some of the tools that we are going to show in the project.
Good morning. My name is Ruben Martinez. I am project coordinator for the STREAM project. I'm also leading the consulting department regarding aviation in ALG.
Morning. Alex Corbacho from ALG. Working within the ETN division in ALG as well, and contributing to STREAM project.
So I'm Sergio Ruiz, I'm a PhD student from Universitat Autònoma of Barcelona, and I'm taking a PhD program in aeronautical management.
I'm Michelangelo Piera from Autonomous University of Barcelona. I'm a full-time professor there and the leader of a research team oriented to logistics
and air transport management group.
Let's continue with the agenda for today's meeting. And I'm going to start presenting a general description and context of the STREAM project, and also I will continue with the first results coming from the first work package of this project, okay? The concept of operations of STREAM. And then I will pass the floor to Sergio Pérez in order to present the work package to outcomes, algorithms, development, and then the floor will go to Javier for presenting the metrics, the assessment methodology, and also the assessment results. Okay? So, regarding the STREAM general. STREAM is an innovative research project looking for defining and validating a new concept and supporting the future ATM. What we detect initially is it was the need for doing something, not a program statement of what are we going to solve or try to solve with the STREAM solutions. Also define a little bit the scope. Currently, the conflict detection and resolution flights, no, flight trajectories, is limited, no, in terms of the look ahead time. No, it's more a tactical activity right now, with limited tools available for the traffic controllers in order to perform this task. This is one of the issues that we would like to solve with the STREAM solution. There is a gap nowadays between the long-term predictive part of the ATM system and the short-term adaptive actions, and very little or more automation support for air traffic control. Mm-hmm. This is something that in the context of CESAR, no, mainly, there are some enablers that are looking for giving solutions in this context, no, in this situation. So this is more or less for the business trajectory and the evolution from the initial trajectory is given by the airlines, the business trajectory, and the RBT. And then also the network operation plan, system-wide rolling plan for network. This is more or less a little bit the enablers that also the STREAM solution could complement and could contribute to be in place. Regarding the objectives of our project, Okay, so we would like to perform conflict detection at SVT and RVT level. We like to do the conflict detection in advance, in a strategic phase. Okay, this is something that could bring several benefits. Okay, we'll see later. So the intermediate objectives, the different activities that we are going to do in the project in order to comply with this high level objective are the following. No? First, to work on time efficient algorithms in order to do the conflict detection and the conflict resolution. Not only giving this tool in the strategic phase, but also giving an enhanced tool, no? with quick or reduced time of calculations, no? For example, running in a linear time with respect to the number of trajectories. Okay? Because at the end, if we work in a strategic phase, the number of trajectories to look at or the geographical areas could be wider. This is something that also we talk about. And also regarding the high quantity of information, regarding these scopes. No? We are all going to work at local, regional, and also the global ICAT level. No? This is a tool that could be applied at different states of the planning or different states of the conflict detection and resolution at different levels, geographical levels. Okay? We need to also check different metrics and to be sure of the capabilities of these algorithms when calculating or when resolving the conflicts. No? And this is an important part of our project, to do a validation assessment of our algorithms in real traffic scenarios and also checking different metrics. No? Like for example, the robustness, the calculations, and also the fairness. No? Because when you have to change some parameters of a flight trajectory, you need to be fair, no, with everybody, with all flights, and so we will also come back to this aspect in detail in the work packages description. These objectives are going or were achieved thanks to this project structure. We have four technical work packages and following a typical sequence in R&D projects. No? First, defining the concept of operations, then developing this concept into a physical or software architecture, no? The algorithms, then prepare the validations with metrics, definition, and also defining the methodology for this assessment, and then performing the assessment. Okay? So this is typical approach. What we did is to propose this approach in two phases. At the beginning of the project, 2 years ago, we had these ideas, no? We had these objectives, we proposed the methodology, activities, but also in this kind of projects, at the end, the scope could vary, no? During the project. You find difficulties or you find shortcuts to do things that we're planning to do it in a different way, to do it in a more efficient way. No? So at the end, we detect in advance that maybe it would be good to have this two-cycle project. No? First, defining the concept and do a first development and first validation, going to a basic solution. This was obtained more or less after 13, 15 months time of work. And then we enter in the second phase of the project in order to refine the algorithms, again, work package 2 activity, refine the metrics, and do again a new validation, considering the outcomes from the basic solution validation, and having this intermediate gate of the project, no, when the validation of the basic solution was performed, in order to do a continuing follow-up of the project and checking if everything was in the right direction. Okay, so I won't enter into the detail of the different deliverables or tasks in each activity. I think this is something to be done more in detail now. Okay, so I will start with Work Package 1. This is the concept of operations. This work package was split into 2 activities. First, the state of the art analysis. Okay, we need to look back, to look at the present activities that are in the same context of the stream project in order to use that as a baseline for us. Okay? Also, to understand what were the problems or different issues that these other activities faced in the past. For us, it was very interesting to understand the operation on the current conflict detection and conflict resolution tools that the controllers and stakeholders were using, no, at that current stage. No? These previous tools supporting controllers for conflict detection and resolution are giving quite a small look-ahead times, no, under 30 minutes. No? This is a tactical phase. would like to check at pre-departure phase, we can start doing the config detection, no? Or even before, no? We will see what is the time horizon. The implementation of these methods, config detection tools across European SPs is not homogeneous. No? There's not a clear standard, a clear homogeneous procedure, no, in place. So this is also an opportunity to give a standard solution, a standard recommendations for these activities. Of course, we are entering in the scope, time scope of the demand capacity balancing activities. So at the end, this is something that also that to be checked, no? How our tools could be integrated in the current DCB function or other network manager functions, no? At the strategic phases. Regarding literature or background, was studied, for example, there's an example. I mean, it's a list of three projects like Erasmus, XO3, and of course the current CSR mainstream, no, with all projects in work package 7, 10, 4. Yeah. At the end, the concept of operations or stream and besides conflict management, resolution, detection and resolution could be part of the network management functions. Could be integrated as activity as a tool, supporting tool, helping or providing this conflict detection resolution at the DCB, at the network manager functions. This will bring benefits like, for example, minimizing the probability of conflicts occurring during the execution. We are entering in this process of the SBT agreement, no, with the users, test users, and also when the network manager need to come back to the users. Okay, I agree this SBT, whatever, we can do preliminary conflict detection or resolution at that stage. Before the RBT is agreed, we can also incorporate the need for minimizing the probability of conflicts during first execution. And this could be a good function in, well, an environment with the traffic demand increasing in the future. Mitigating the estimated impact on the system. Okay, this is again moving from tactical to strategic. No? A tactical conflict detection resolution is done, what we need to do it, no? Safety, and maybe the parameters, I mean, or the criteria implemented is different from the criteria that we can implement in advance, no? Metrics, no? Fairness, etc. At the end, the costs, this is linking to the previous one, no? The cost of moving a trajectory in a tactical phase and moving in advance before could be less, no? for the users and also for the system, no? For the network manager functions also. Just a summary for the concept of operations. The stream solution intends to be applied to 4D trajectories, and we are going to store them in a special data structure. This is one of the techniques used by the algorithms for detecting and solving the conflict. So this special data structure that will be detailed by Sergio later on have already been submitted. No? These trajectories have already been submitted to the preliminary DCB for the slots, previous negotiations, are still published as SBTs, and then when analyzing the stream, we work with a time horizon prior to the takeoff. We'll do a takeoff of flights, this is going to last the time horizon, and also in this time horizon, we can find trajectories already agreed, no? RBTs. So those also will be part of the conflict detection. And then regarding conflict resolution, those RBTs, we need to check if they can be changed or not. Because an RBT, there are some constraints that need to be considered. No? Maybe an RBT in a specific time cannot be changed. This solution that algorithms are applying permit to configure the resolutions independently of the airspace sector or sector capacities configuration. We can have the same solution working in different airspace sectors configurations and also with dynamic sectorization. We don't need to change the algorithm, it's adapted to any change in the airspace design. Also, a stream solution is suitable for implementing Module 25 where there is a priority on the traffic, no, in congested airspaces. Then of reducing traffic complexity, where this eventually implies a reduction of available capacity. Okay, we can prioritize or incorporate different priorities resolution of the conflicts. We need to consider a global traffic picture, our scope, geographical scope, the one that we performed in our developments and validations, is a global one, no, in order to identify critical situations of high congestion and workload or spots. And the stream solution will permit this, no, to really have a clear view of which points of our network are more critical, no, in this sense. We can resolve conflicts in order to avoid increasing complexity and the preparation of those conflicts. So this is one of the objectives of our algorithms, to reduce the propagation of conflicts, to look for a solution that really is a solution, not only at the local level, but also at the network level. And again, consider the user preferences in order to achieve fairness. No? This is something that has been validated with the metrics. This is the introduction and the concepts, concept applications description. So maybe now it's time to pass the floor to Michelangelo.
First of all, very few words about the introduction of Word Package Zoom. The main research motivation for this, for the work we have been developing, has been to design and deploy a platform to exploit pre-flight information in order to improve the latent capacity that right now we have in present ATM systems. When I'm talking about pre-flight information, we know that we are talking about big data problems that could be focused mainly on macro level solutions or micro level solutions. What we have developed is an innovative approach based on the state space analysis in order to develop a conflict detection tool that could be implemented in a very efficient way. When I'm talking about computational efficiency, I'm talking that we can detect all the conflict between 4,000 trajectories in less than 5 seconds, according to the computer we are using, in such a way that this efficiency, this computational efficiency, allows us to introduce changes at real time. In fact, we develop a driver to link the conflict detection tool with the Stream platform. And also we can introduce changes from the shared business trajectories information and or changes from the reference business trajectory. On the other side, also we implemented a conflict resolution tool in a modular way. Besides that, right now we focus, we'll see later on technical details, we focus on hack alternatives. It can be implemented also flight levels and also speed changes. But the innovation part of the conflict resolution is that we can support a collaborative decision-making approach in order to deal with a trade-off between aerospace user requirements and also ATM requirements. In the baseline, is the innovative approach in which we develop a state space analysis tool based on causal analysis. In fact, we have been relying most of these ideas from the colored Petri net modeling approach. Using this approach, we can support micro level representation, 4DT, but we can also exploit flow approaches from this micro level description of the system. The development has been highly modular and flexible in such a way that we develop a conflict detection module independent of the conflict resolution module. So we can plug conflict resolution module from aerospace users, and both of them rely the information on the state space analysis, in which we use the approach of colored Petri net to deal with the reachability tree. Reachability tree somehow allows us to understand in a transparent way which are the consequences of proposing this conflict resolution, which are the downstream consequences of this resolution, or to obtain a trade-off between, look at this, there are several solutions, which one could provide a trade-off according to different methods, okay? So my colleague will go inside the details of all this, of the conflict detection and conflict resolution.
Here I will present the logical functioning of the algorithm, of the architecture. In the first place, we have as an input the flight plans of the airlines. We assume here that the original trajectories are the most preferred. And in fact, in Stream, we assume the concept of free routing, simplified as direct routing. We have a set of direct routes entering in the system. They come to the in-conflict detection, and they are stored in a database, which is called a special data structure. I will give details later on. And then the conflict detection is performed with the help of the special data structure, and the conflict detective sent to another module, which is belonging to the conflict resolution module. In that module, we generate alternative trajectories, alternative resolution amendment for the conflict detective. We interpret each conflict as a restriction of the network manager, define it in space and in time. It's a 4D restriction. And in the module, in the resolution trajectory generator module, we generate the trial trajectories. In this case, we assume in the either case is the proper user who can generate a resolution trajectory, having into account the 4D restriction given by the network manager. As a simplification, we use a geometric optimization approach, which is a tomography algorithm developed by NASA, just to have new trajectories that solve at least one of the conflicts detected in the conflict detection model. So the trial directories are sent to the conflict detection model again and is stored in the spatial data structure. Again, the conflict detection is performed and we have new information, state space information of the ATM. In the left table, we have all the aircraft in the network and the potential trajectories that they could fly. At least we have the original trajectory. We can also have, in case if the original trajectory was in conflict, we can have also additional trial trajectory. And then the right table is about the conflicts, the conflict generated between the original trajectories or also between the original or the resolution trajectory. And this information is sent to another part of the conflict resolution module, which is based on causal analysis. It aims to solve the conflicts with a network perspective, a global scope. At the end of the process, we will have not only one network solution, conflict-free solution, but several network solutions. Well, the spatial data structure is a spatial database which sorts the information according to the space that a trajectory occupies, an aircraft occupies in a spatial region, in the airspace in this case. The structure of the database provides with efficient access mode, access methods for reading and writing information in the database. It helps to linearize the conflict detection analysis. For example, if we introduce a trajectory, we save all the positions at each time of the aircraft. We introduce this information in the database according to the location of the flight. Then we introduce a second trajectory and we do the same. We store all the information, but when a spatial resource, a coordinate or eye area is shaped between more than one trajectory, then there is a comparison in distance or comparing the time windows, for example, and this is how we perform the conflict detection, by comparing the trajectories only on those places where the space is shared among the trajectories. For example, if we introduce a third trajectory, this trajectory is not sharing space, spatial resources with any other trajectories, and then it is stored directly in the database and no comparison is needed. The performance of the conflict detection is faster and it is running in linear time. So under STEAM we developed some innovations, two new concepts of spatial data structures. One is the time-space data structure. We introduce the time, not only the space, but also the time to sort the information, the 4D information of the system, and it provides with faster conflict detection. And also, we need to rethink the logical structure to fit all the ATM information in a computer. It's more a memory management issue, but the relational spatial data structure allows to reduce the memory in a 99% at least for the same problems. We use in STEAM spatial data structures can be configured in different ways. Here in STEAM we use for pruning the comparisons by first looking at the neighbors of a given trajectory and then only performing pairwise comparison between the neighbors. We have here a bidimensional view, but this is done in four dimensions. The pruning is very powerful. And then here we have the chart showing pairwise conflict detection without any kind of filter, which shows quadratic complexity, quadratic runtime, and the green line is the performance shown by the STEAM tool, with showing like with 5,000 trajectories, like 10 seconds in the conflict detection model. One of the problems that we face it in STEAM is that we needed to consider a big region at European scale. So we had to consider not only the memory issues, which was a very big problem, but also we had to consider the curvature of the Earth. And then we developed what we call geodesic SDS, which is basically the difference is that it has a variable bin size. The results are that even with the variable bin size, the filtering performance is very good. In the conflict resolution module, we use it geometric optimization approach, as I said. It is an approximation of what we assume that are the expert users' preferred routes. For each conflict, we could consider the preferred route for solving this conflict and not necessarily the solution provided in the STEAM. The key target is to have local optimal trajectories for each detected conflict. The Go algorithm provides with efficient formulae, mathematical formulae to obtain local optimal resolution trajectory. Third, we assume in stream daily routes, as I said, at the strategic level. But the same algorithms on the same platform can be adapted to work in the current structured route for tactical confrontation resolution purposes. One of the key things of the conflict resolution problem is the emergent dynamics when we try to solve a conflict within a network. In this complex system, we can have several emergent dynamics when trying to solve a single conflict if we only look at the local level. It makes the problem to be a non-polynomial problem, which is growing exponentially in complexity. So it's very difficult to solve the problem by pure combinatorial analysis. We identified some of the conflicts that we can have in the system. For example, the secondary conflicts or tertiary conflicts or downstream conflicts. But one thing is important to note is that Billy Moria, which is a researcher from NASA, identified that network effects or domino effects, so it's named the emerging dynamics, can have an stabilizing effect or a destabilizing effect. So when trying to solve a conflict, we can generate a new conflict in the network, so it's the stabilizing effect, but also sometimes occurs that when solving a conflict, you can also solve another conflict that was previously in the network and it will be in the network anymore. In the Billy Moria performance research, he demonstrates that the domino effects are very important to be considered for network planning. We developed here a module to perform causal analysis to consider the domino effects, the secondary tertiary conflicts between local optimal trajectories. Well, this slide is showing a little bit a graphical view of a simplified scenario with the several combinations. The left side shows the same scenario represented by a causal model, which is then implemented in a computer. The causal models have several advantages. On the one hand, reduce a combinatorial by interpreting and modeling the emergent dynamics of the system, we can reduce quite a lot the combinatorial exploration of the system. This is one of the advantages that we also sum a clustering strategy. We take the whole network and divide the problems in sub-problems that are unconnected among them. The solution space of each problem, the sum of the solution spaces are much lower than considering all the combinations or the combinatorial among all the network. At the end, in the algorithm provided by Stream, we consider some of the strategies, considering also the information provided by the preferences of the space users. In order to only look among all the solution space, we only perform a search of solutions in the Pareto efficient frontier. So we reduce a lot the combinatorial exploration. Here we perform a simulation in a simplified scenario, but highly interactive scenario. We have 20 trajectories lasting half an hour, each one, and we detected 10 conflicts. But the 10 conflicts were solved with only 6 movements in the trajectories. This is the optimal solution for this reduced scenario. We can use the domino effects, taking advantage of the positive destabilizing network effects, just to try to move those trajectories, identify those trajectories that can solve more conflicts, and at the end have a conflict-free network scenario. Here, the same algorithms were tested at the European scale. And these are the results obtained. For example, with 4,000 trajectories, we detected 211 nominal conflicts. These are direct routes, as I said. For example, in the case we applied distance in the resolutions of 7 nautical miles and 10 nautical miles when a conflict is detected. And then in those scenarios, we provided a solution only moving, in the case of 7 nautical miles, only moving 193 trajectories to solve the 211 nominal conflict and 186 in the case of 10 nautical miles. And this was simulated only 78 seconds in a medium power computer, and this is the disaggregated times in the 8 seconds in the conflict detection and 41.8 in the solution with Goa algorithms, clustering 9 seconds, and at the end the causal analysis 20 seconds. So these times allows to run every 2 minutes or every 1 minute if we use a more powerful computer, just to update all the information and adapt to the changes in the network. As a summary, we have identified some of the most interesting KPIs of the SSR, among them capacity. As we are strategically deconflicting the network, we expect to reduce the APC workload, so we can expect a gain on capacity. We use the CDM philosophy, so the users can participate through the free route concept. They can develop their own preferred trajectories, but also they can take a participation on the global decisions. We have provided a global scope with the whole ECAP and examining the potential emergent dynamics of the network. We provided with efficiency, specifically using the concept of free route. We provided equity and fairness through some of the metrics that we will explain it later. Flexibility, which means the capacity to adapt to the network changes. And of course, some of the other SSR concepts, like for the trajectories, CDM, and also we connected the platform with real data taken from SWIM and so on. These are some of the potential improvements that can be done in the current platform. For example, the use of the stream algorithms are basically focused on network management purposes, and we can also improve the general ATM. And also, we can provide the algorithms with some macroscopic information. For example, we can provide right now with conflict-free network, but probably as an intermediate step, we can consider some complexity metrics in order to say, okay, we can provide to the network with a conflict-free network, but in this sector, the complexity metrics say that you are overloading the sector, so you have to take another decision because we don't want the sector to be overloaded. Also, we can add more state and space information to the spatial data structure. Up to now, we used only a simplified for the APM model, but we can think of a more complex APM model, introducing weather information or probabilistic information in the trajectory predictor, for example. Also, we can integrate the system with SWIM. We did a proof of concept of that. Also, we can develop new multi-access modes to the SDS just to share the information and to provide access to real space users. Another point to further work is, well, we provided a baseline for collaborative flight planning and field concepts, but it can be improved in a more realistic way with weather forecasts and so on. And we can adapt the whole architecture to uncertainty. Specifically, we will see later that we can use right now the architecture to study the optimal size of the safety distances in the strategic level. We can also use temporal looseness information, which means that can we move a trajectory, delay or advance a trajectory without having interactions in the network. We can add the probabilistic information. Well, we can improve the whole architecture just to ensure a real-time knock. Another thing which is quite interesting is that right now in a SIM, we are only looking within the same 2 hours time window, but this is like a dynamic rolling system. Every 2 minutes, we could have a new time window, and we discovered in this project that these time windows are not unconnected. The decision you make in the first 2 hour time window may affect to the other the coming new 2 hour time windows in the future. So it should be further studied. And we have now the platform to do that.
Okay, thank you, Sergio. So now we can continue with work package 3 results. This is the assessment methodology and metrics.
In this work package 3, we wanted to develop a set of metrics and also a methodology to really measure what is going to be the impact of the stream algorithm in the ATM performance and also in the operational efficiency of the system. On one hand, we consider the perspective of both airspace users and also ATM service providers, And also we have a special emphasis in the impact of the user flag cost and how the cost penalty that we can associate to the completion algorithm is distributed among different users. And I think we developed two metrics, that is fairness and equity, that I will explain later on. Apart from defining the metrics, the World Bank also developed a methodology to evaluate these proposed metrics in a specific set of scenarios. And also, this methodology can further be expanded from other different scenarios, different from the one that we specifically use in World Bank 4, that I will explain later, to have some preliminary feeling of how the behavior of the algorithm that Sergio was explaining. To define this methodology, we started with focusing in a specific traffic sample, and also we had to tune the simulation toolset that we have. Also, we need to establish the baseline scenarios that we are going to use to study the performance. There are certain context variables that can be tuned to adapt the algorithms and also the methodology to other different experiments. As I was saying before, one of the outcomes of this work package 3 was a set of metrics. We divided the metrics in basically three groups. The first group is related with ATN system performance metric, and here we find the typical metrics like delay, traffic density, peak load, then metrics related directly related with the conflict detection and resolution performance, that is a number of conflicts, a conflict resolution success rate. Also, we developed a metric that is the impact on capacity that basically give you a feeling of if after using the recompletion algorithms, we kind of gain more potential capacity in the sector, either because the traffic density has been reduced or maybe because of the peak load or because the number of conflicts of that sector has been reduced. And also we have emissions that are directly related with the amount of fuel burn. For the operational efficiency metric, we consider two metrics. One is the user fuel efficiency. Here we can apply this metric for comparing the different flights, but also comparing different airspace users. Dividing the set of flights that we were studying in different airspace users, we can kind of compare what is the user fuel efficiency for each of these airspace users. And the same for the user cost efficiency. Also the user cost efficiency take into account the losses because of potential delays that are coming from the deconfliction algorithm. Finally, we have the fairness and equity metrics that basically measure how well balanced is the distribution of the cost penalty among the different flights or among the different users. This is just a quick overview of the different metrics and the formula. I mean, there are more information in the document. We have the delay that basically measures the time difference between the scheduled time at a certain point and that time after the deconfliction. And we have also the traffic density that is an average of the number of aircraft in a specific sector or region, the peak load, the maximum number of aircraft that are simultaneously flying in a specific sector. We have emissions that, as you can see from the formula, are directly related with the fuel consumption. Number of conflicts detected by the conflict detection algorithm, conflict resolution success rate, how or many of those conflicts were truly deconflicted, the impact of capacity that basically give you, as I say before, feelings after the confliction is going to be potential capacity available in the sector. And the way we proposed to measure this metric was like looking at the peak load, looking at the traffic density, and also the difference between the number of conflicts. It was a kind of a simplistic way to look if the sector will become a capacity constraint or, on the other hand, is possible to allocate more aircraft in that sector. So depending on the value that you are getting in this impact on capacity metric, that basically here is an overview of the different possibilities, a person that look at that metric can say, okay, in this specific sector is more constrained after the confliction, or in this other sector, more aircraft could be potentially allocated. This can, of course, be related with the workload of the air traffic controller that is looking at the sector. This is just a quick example of how this metric will look like. I mean, you have here a simplistic way of defining four sectors. There are four flights, so three potential conflicts, two sectors doesn't have any conflict, and one sector has two conflicts, and the other sector has one conflict. And after the confliction, you have two new trajectories that create an increment of traffic density in the upper left corner of this drone, of this figure, of the right figure. Also, two sectors that they have conflict one sector doesn't have any conflict after the confliction, so there are some potential capacity available, and the other sector, the number of conflicts is reduced, so again, some capacity is also available, could be potentially available in that sector. So it's just a measure of the deconfliction has a negative impact, a neutral impact, or a positive impact on the capacity. Regarding the operational efficiency metrics, we have the user fuel efficiency. So basically, you just compare the fuel burn before the confliction and after the confliction of the whole traffic. The user cost efficiency, the same, but directly related with the cost. So the cost also, apart from considering the cost because of the fuel burn, also take into account the impact of the delay through the cost index into the cost. And again, these two metrics can be applied per flight, comparing flights among themselves or comparing airspace users. Then we have the fairness metric. The idea of this metric is to see how is the allocation of the different cost penalty among the different flights or among the different airspace users, considering that each flight or each airspace user has a cost penalty threshold. I mean, a maximum value of cost that the airline or the flight is willing to give to the network, to improve the network, but without absorbing too much cost because of the deconfliction of the ATC intervention. This fairness metric gives you a feeling of the cost penalties after the confliction, like evenly distributed among the different flights or among the different airspace users, according with their cost penalty threshold. So some airlines or some flights, they are more restrictive with the amount of cost that they are willing to share or to trade with the network, and others maybe they won't have such a problem. This is equivalent to the previous slide, but with the formula for airspace users. The equity metric also check how the cost penalty has been distributed among the flight or user, but without considering this cost penalty threshold. So again, it can be applied per flight and also per airspace user. I mean, more information, of course, is available in the documentation. I'm going pretty quick through this slide, but it's just definition and formula. So anyway, if later on anyone have a question, we can go directly to one of these slides. The methodology that we also developed in this work package to evaluate the performance of the conflict detection and conflict resolution algorithm is a basic methodology, but I mean, it was enough for getting the result we wanted to study. So basically, everything started with having a shared business trajectory that in this case we consider the flight plan. Then through a high fidelity trajectory generation, we create true trajectory. What is the reference trajectory? What is the optimal trajectory that an airline or a specific flight from an airline want to fly? Once having all the traffic converted in true trajectories, in business trajectories, we run the algorithms, the conflict detection and conflict resolution algorithms. We will detect a certain number of conflicts, and as Sergio explained before, we modify certain number of those trajectories until the conflict resolution say okay, the conflict detection say okay, I'm not detecting any more conflicts, so we can continue. Then we'll obtain an update of the flight plan that here is called a modified shared business trajectory. This shared business trajectory will go back to the traffic generation infrastructure and will regenerate a true modified trajectory. And then it's just a question of comparing the trajectories of both samples, the true trajectories and the true modified trajectories. And we apply the metric I was explaining before. Metric related with the number of conflict, with the ATM system performance, fairness and equity, and also related with the operational efficiency. Also, I mean, as part of the discussion we had with Colin and Leila, we wanted also to have a feeling of what could be the impact of uncertainty and the robustness of this conflict detection and resolution algorithm. For doing that, we use the same configuration. I mean, we have the shared business trajectory, we generate true trajectories, but in this case, we perturbate these true trajectories, introducing a trajectory prediction, an error. As I will explain later on, this error that we introduced was we focus in just modeling two type of errors. ETD error, estimated time of departure error, and a long track trajectory prediction error that could be, for example, the consequence of not having updated weather models, or maybe the wind that you are using for your prediction is different than the wind that actually the aircraft is going to encounter when it flies the flight plan. So we capture that uncertainty with this trajectory prediction, with this along track trajectory prediction error. After perturbing these trajectories, we again go through the conflict detection and conflict resolution algorithm. We will obtain a new flight plan. We will then regenerate trajectories. And in this case, for this particular scenario, we just wanted to check the robustness of the conflict detection and resolution. We just focus in the metric related with the number of conflicts. What was the number of conflict that was detected? What was the number of conflict that was really in the scenario, and also the conflict resolution rate. This is just briefly a summary of what we obtained from World Package 3, basically a set of metrics, that are the metrics I explained before, a methodology to evaluate these string algorithms according to these proposed metrics, and also a methodology that shows the capability to evaluate the robustness of these algorithms and the impact of uncertainty on the trajectory prediction and algorithm performance. These capabilities that we develop in World Package 2, the conflict detection and conflict resolution, and the metrics that we were developing in World Package 3, in World Package 4, we kind of did a feasibility study to testing these algorithms, the simulation tools, and also the metrics and the methodology. So the conclusion that we were getting in World Package 4 is just some preliminary conclusion from just running all these algorithms and evaluating the algorithm with the metrics in several scenarios. But of course, I mean, if we want to have a deeper understanding of the algorithms, more simulations are needed to be done to really obtain some kind of statistical conclusions. That is not the case that we did, because we just focus in few scenarios. For the World Package 4, as I said before, we wanted to evaluate the performance of the algorithms according with the metrics, and also the impact of the uncertainty in the robustness of the algorithms. The variables that we have to configure the simulation, we can use any traffic sample. The airspace configuration, we need to put some airspace limits for the conflict detection tool. We can divide the airspace in a specific number of sectors. As I will explain later on, the way we divided the airspace was very simplistic because we wanted just to show the capability. But the sector distribution doesn't have any similarity with the real, maybe just the number of sectors, but not the configuration of those sectors. We are able to configure the traffic. We can allocate different cost index. We can distribute the flights or the traffic sample in different airspace users. We can also put or allocate different cost penalty threshold to the airspace users or the flight. In the case of the specific study that we did in World Package 4, Sergio was introducing before, we focused in direct routes. We wanted to explore the free routing concept. Also, we can filter the traffic depending on the sector and time. The stream algorithms can also be parameterized. We show that we run this experiment for two different detection and resolution buffers. I mean, a configuration in the conflict resolution tool. The conflict detection was done in 5 nautical miles, if I'm not wrong. And then the conflict resolution algorithm was parameterized to have an inter-aircraft distance of 7 nautical miles and 10 nautical miles. And also, we are able to introduce some uncertainty sources to our simulation. In this case, we introduce the estimated time of departure and the on-track TP error. This is just a slide showing the tools. We have a quite sophisticated trajectory generation module, and also another module to be able to evaluate different set of metrics. This is the configuration of the scenario that I will show later on in some of the preliminary results. I mean, we have this European airspace. We asked for recorded data to Leila and Colin. They provide us like one busy day, one of the busiest days in 2011. So it was like around 26,000 flights in that day. We wanted to find an interval with enough traffic density to really test the conflict detection and the conflict resolution algorithm. We choose a time interval of 2 hours, and in those 2 hours, there were like around 4,000 trajectories flying in the European airspace. We kind of focus the conflict detection and the conflict resolution in that area, although we simulate all the trajectories from airport to airport. For the conflict detection, conflict resolution, and also for evaluating the metric, we just focus in that region of the airspace. So basically, here are the definition of this airspace, like the longitude, the latitude, Also, the flight levels, we just consider flight level from flight level 100 to flight level 430. That was mainly because many of the aircraft that were flying below flight level 100 were turboprops, and the performance data were kind of more difficult to find. So it was a way kind of to simplify the complexity of the traffic. And also, we configured the airspace in two different sectorizations. A simple one, that it was just for testing purposes, that it was just 16 sectors. And another one that is more close to reality in the number of sectors, that it was like 256 sectors. But of course, for you guys, when looking at the airspace configuration, there are some regions of Europe that the sectors are much smaller than the one shown here. And also, we just use a grid for the sector that doesn't have any similarity with the real airspace structure. But this was just to show that the capabilities, doesn't matter what airspace configuration or what is the sectorization you use, the methodology applies the same and the metrics applies the same. As I was saying before, we also configured the simulation to generate the trajectories as direct routes. The simulation can generate trajectories following any specific flight plan that required to be direct route, but we thought that was quite interesting, as Sergio was saying, to think in a futuristic flight routing procedure. As I said before, we configured the airspace in these two different sectorizations. Also, we apply filtering of the trajectories in the specific sectors. So we had to filter the trajectories per flight level. Also to filter trajectories according to time. Here is just a snapshot of basically what we did, how we configured for the two different assessments that we did, how we configured the scenario, and what were the things that we were studying. So in both scenarios, in the first scenario was a final performance assessment of the algorithm. So we wanted to check what is the performance of the algorithms according with the metrics that we develop in World Package 3, according with the APM system performance, the operational efficiency, fairness and equity. So we use direct route configuration of the scenario. We have the 4,010 flights in 2 hours. As I say in the methodology, we started with the flight plan, we generate the trajectories, that this was the baseline scenario, we apply the conflict detection and the conflict resolution algorithm, we generate a new flight plan, we regenerate trajectories, that is supposed to be the conflicted scenario, and we check if we really deconflict the traffic. So we apply again the conflict detection. For evaluating the metrics, we have the baseline scenario, I mean the reference business trajectory that the aircraft wanted to fly, and the deconflicted scenario, that it was the same scenario but modifying certain trajectories and certain flight plans according with the conflict detection and conflict resolution. As I said before, we had two different conflict resolution parametrization, so the results I will show in the next slide. We're comparing these two different parametrizations of the conflict resolution. If we apply a buffer of 7 nautical miles or we apply a buffer of 10 nautical miles for the conflict detection and conflict resolution. Also, we define these artificial sectors to evaluate the conflict detection and resolution performance and capacity imbalance, that is these 16 and 256 sectors, in order to evaluate the operational efficiency and also fairness and equity. We apply different cost in for the flight. We didn't have information from the data we had. So basically we did it randomly. So we choose 3 different intervals for the distribution of cost index among the 4,000 flights. All the aircraft flying at minimum cost index 0, or aircraft flying between cost index 0 and 400, or just to really stress in the cost the importance of delay, we also put a cost index between 0 and 10,000. So the higher is the cost index basically, the airline put more importance in the delay in the cost than the fuel. For studying how this metric applies to different airspace users, we consider all the flights belonging to one airline, so basically you are just comparing the flights among themselves, or if the flights are distributed randomly in 100 airlines or 400 airlines. Anyway, this distribution was done randomly, the same that the cost index, because we didn't have enough information. And I mean, for the sake of the simulation, doesn't really have an importance how you manage this. For the robustness and uncertainty impact analysis, we have again the same scenario with direct route, the 4,000 flights. We also generate two different scenarios for two different estimated time of departure error and another two different scenarios for two different along track TP errors. So in this case, we have four different scenarios to compare the robustness of the conflict detection and conflict resolution. Again, this is just to have a feeling of the behavior of the algorithm. I mean, if you really want to have some qualitative number, you really need to do some statistical approach to obtain a result that you can truly believe, because I mean, are statistically based. So also here we configure the conflict resolution for this 7 and 10 nautical miles inter-aircraft distance. Basically, the only metric we evaluate was the number of conflict detected and the conflict resolution success rate. The next slide is just some figures that you can find in the documentation to show some of the results. Here is just some of the graphs we get from the traffic density. One of the conclusions is that we have 4,000 trajectories. From those 4,000, only around 180 to 190 trajectories were the ones that were modified. The modification were pretty close to the nominal trajectory, so we didn't have any big impact, especially for the 16 sector, because the sector sectorization, the sectors are pretty large, but also for the 256 sectors, we didn't find a huge impact on the traffic density or the peak load. Again, you have to consider that we consider direct routes and also the sectorization, it was just a grid. But anyway, this just shows that we have the capability to study these things. On the other hand, for the conflict detection and conflict resolution, we really have an impact, of course. We were passing from a maximum of around 16 conflicts that could be in a specific sector. Here I'm talking about the 16 sector sectorization. In the 256 sector, the maximum number of conflicts per sector was around 10 to 20. As you can see in the graphs, the number of conflicts decreased dramatically in the different sectors. We observed that for the 10 nautical miles configuration of the conflict resolution, because the trajectories deviate more from the nominal trajectory, because you need to have bigger buffers, I will show in the next slide, the conflict resolution success rate was smaller than in the 7 nautical miles buffer configuration. In the 7 nautical miles configuration, the number of conflicts after resolution was around 30, and for the 10 nautical miles was 35. So there were more conflicts after the conflict detection and resolution in the 10 nautical miles parametrization than in the 7 nautical miles. So here is the conflict success rate per sector. So as you can see in the 10 nautical miles sectorization, there were some sectors in where the success rate was smaller than in the case of the 7 nautical miles version. This is just the impact on capacity. You can see that in some of the sectors, especially the sectors that are numbered from 6 to 11, the gain of capacity because of the resolution, of course you are decreasing the number of conflicts from around 180, 190 to only around 30. There is a potential gain on capacity on those sectors. Equivalent results were obtained for the 256 sectors, but we also observed that, of course, because the sectors were smaller, the deviation after the confliction create that some sectors become capacity constrained. In the case of the 16 sector sectorization, everything was wonderful and positive, but in the 256 sectorization, there were some spikes going down, meaning that those specific sectors might have some problems in terms of capacity, because there were maybe some additional conflict that was generated after the confliction that it wasn't there before. This table just shows some numbers for the operational efficiency metric. Basically, the 10 nautical miles parametrization of the algorithm for this, as I said, preliminary assessment of the performance of the algorithm, we observed that it worked better in terms of operational efficiency, mainly because the number of aircraft that they were touched were smaller than in the case of the 7 nautical miles. If I don't remember wrong, there were like 180 something aircraft touched for the 10 nautical miles parametrization and only 183 for the 7 nautical miles configuration of the conflict resolutions. So the results are better in terms of emission and in terms of fuel efficiency and also in terms of user cost efficiency independently of the cost index. And here are some results regarding the fairness and equity. So we observe that in the 10 nautical mile version of the algorithm, parameterization of the algorithm, results in a fairer and more equitable distribution of the cost penalties among the different flights, again, independently of the cost index. We wanted also to test the robustness and the impact of uncertainty in the conflict detection and conflict resolution performance. These are just some of the results. What we have is the 7 nautical miles and the 10 nautical miles parameterization. We have the number of conflicts detected for the nominal trajectory, and when we added uncertainty in a long track TP error, that are the next two columns, the WE1, WE2, and when we added the estimated time of departure error, we see the amount of conflict detected after processing the resolution strategy. And also, we see the success rate in the same cases. So we can observe that the ETD error has a larger impact on the robustness of the algorithm than the along track TP error, at least for the kind of TP error distribution that we use. Here maybe Sergio can explain better this slide.
In the first case, we used a nominal safety distance for detecting conflicts of 5 nautical miles, but we were interested also in observing what happened when we increased the distance for detecting conflicts. And the results where basically we have the same information in the columns, we have the same scenarios, the nominal and the TP error and the estimated time of departure error for different safety distance applied to the conflict detection. We observed that in the case of the 10 nautical miles, more or less we have the same number of conflicts, which suggests that by ensuring distance between all the trajectories of 10 nautical miles, maybe 12, and solving them with the conflict resolution also applying 10 nautical miles, so ensuring 10 nautical miles in all the network, it is expected to have a more robust network. But there is a trade-off, because also we have almost the double number of conflicts, so the double of resolution amendments is expected as well, so it makes worse the flight efficiency. We also expect more equity according to the metrics, but this also to be studied in the trade-off. As we are ensuring more distance between aircraft, we can fit less aircraft in the same airspace. But it affects capacity, because nowadays the capacity is not restricted by the airspace limitations, but by the controller workload. It should be further studied what's the impact on the real capacity of the system, but increasing at a strategic level the safety distance ensured among all the trajectories. Another thing that we found is that, remember that we analyze with causal models in unconnected clusters, unconnected scenarios. So trajectories that are in conflict among them, and we try to find solutions in these reduced scenarios. And it is important the size of the cluster, because we explore in a combinatorial way. So the important thing here is that independently of the scenario, usually the scenarios are distributed like this. The 98% of the cluster has a size of 8 aircraft, which is the size we currently consider that is a big cluster to explore by combinatoria. The clusters bigger than 8 aircraft should be reclusterized by, for example, applying fly layers, steps, and so on. The rest of the clusters can be efficiently analyzed. So that's the results in this experiment.
This is just a summary from the World Package 4. We have the capability of understanding and measuring the performance of this string solution relative to operational efficiency, ATN system performance, fairness and equity, and the impact on capacity. The proposed methodology for the simulation and the assessment was validated in this World Package 4. We get some preliminary conclusion, as I said, of the conflict detection and conflict resolution algorithm performance according to the metrics that we use. This also was a valuable feedback for us to kind of understand how could be the further work to improve the algorithms or to measure the algorithms. We show that there is a capability to perform a robustness analysis of the conflict detection and conflict resolution algorithms, and we were able to evaluate the impact of uncertainty in trajectory prediction. All the results of World Package 4 are preliminary. We use this set of configuration explained at the beginning of this World Package 4 presentation
different configurations can be done. A statistical analysis could be potentially done. Nothing really changed because the simulation and the methodology is prepared to do it. And of course, we are also happy to gather ideas from you guys of how we can further exploit the capabilities that we have been showing during this work package 2 to 4. And that's all.
Okay, thank you, Javier. So now it is time for your questions.
Thank you very much for that. I think stuck together a full explanation of 2 years of working in 1 hour. Any questions? Anyone? Let's start at the back end.
I'll start with 2 questions. For the climb and descent part of the flight, how do you deal with this? Because your model apparently works very well for the route. How do you deal with climb and descent phase?
The way we model the trajectory were modeled completely. I mean, climb phase and route and descent. The only part we didn't model was the takeoff, the first part of the climb, because we didn't have the airport configuration, the seats. For all the airports in Europe, so we started at around 3,000 feet at the airport, and we just climbed straight to the cruise level that was provided by the data that we gathered from Eurocontrol, and the same for descent. I mean, we modeled the descent, a continuous descent approach up to again 3,000 feet, because I mean we have the capability to model, but we don't have the data to model all the start. So then, once having the complete trajectory from airport to airport, considering climb, route, and distance, because we wanted to study strategically the conflict, we focused just in the in route part. So we filter those trajectories that, again, complete trajectory with a true top of climb, a true top of distance, and we just keep the route part for the conflict detection and conflict resolution part. So the conflict detection and conflict resolution was done just in the en route part.
Yeah, because most of the conflicts are in the climb and descent. Probably 80% of the conflicts, they are in the phase you are not looking at.
But you need to think that what we were testing here is strategically the confliction of the traffic, of course. There are many potential conflicts, as you were saying, in departure and also in descent, in the terminal area. But it's like we were just checking to the conflict, I would say, at the same level that maybe the CFMU are doing it.
Okay, the second question. So you initially, if I understand well, so you calculate for the whole network and the flight turn phase, so before the aircraft is on the ground. How often do you update this? After the aircraft takes off, how often do you update this?
Everything was a strategy, so it's everything is pre-departure.
So you never update it?
Exactly. I mean, we just consider a 2 hours interval, but as Sergio was saying, we can further do updates. I mean, we could potentially recalculate trajectories after departure, update the flight plan so we can regenerate the trajectories, and we can pass those trajectories again into the conflict detection and resolution. The concept will work the same, but it's true that we didn't do an analysis in where what happened if we update things continually. But it's because we wanted to keep the strategy.
Yeah, the algorithms are ready for working in that updated, rolling updated scenario, but we didn't validate that in the scope of a stream project, the metrics or the functionality of that rolling updated.
In fact, you replaced the allocation of delay allocation that is used by CFU today by a conflict resolution, and that's what you did. It's not a real computer resolution as you did it, as you can make it in a tactical way, but it's just that you changed the measures that an ATFL today can do by computer resolution. Mm-hmm. This is what is the purpose of this program. Mm-hmm.
Yes, well,
so you can do it in dynamic way, so you can also introduce trajectories that have been already depart from that are already, it's exactly as CASA today, it's mm-hmm. the CFM, but the problem is, what is it efficient in
what you're doing? I mean, as Sergio was saying, because the time for conflict detection and conflict resolution is pretty small. Actually, if you check it, we are talking here about a few seconds for 4,000 trajectory. So actually, it permits you kind of update flight plans, trajectories, and go back again to check the conflict.
I want to add that, for example, in the question of the what about the in the TMA, we were making only direct routes without only in en route, because mainly it is difficult to generate optimal resolution routes. But ideally, these new trajectories would be provided by the airspace users. The network manager give them restrictions in 4D, in space and time. So we detect a conflict, maybe climbing and en route or climbing descent, and we provide to the airspace users with a restriction in space and time, and we expect to obtain a new trajectory, optimize it. So the same architecture could be used also in TMA, but further studies should be done because there is also the airport logistics that may complicate the thing. No? But the architecture is prepared to lead with the same dynamic route allocation concept, both in en route and in TMA. That's one. And another thing is about the updating rate, which we are only performing one simulation in a 2-hour time window, okay? But it is expected to move this 2-hour time windows every, for example, 1 minute, 2 minutes, okay? In order to adapt the network structure, the route allocation to the changes, because maybe we plan the network with a 2-hour with the conflict the network with a 2-hour time window, but 1 hour later, for example, appears a severe weather, a storm or something, or I don't know, military people close a sector or something like that, and you have to reconfigure the network. But as soon as you have the information, the new information from the ATM, you can adapt very fast to the new. But the thing I stated at the beginning is that we have to further study what implications have between these time windows, 2-hour time windows slicing, because they are not unconnected. So the decisions you are taking now, maybe you should think that what are the risks of changes in the network 2 hours later, in order to make better decisions for the future. You know, it's quite complicated because this is slicing, but this is not studied in a stream. We provided the platform in order to enable this kind of studies.
For me, you have two problems, right? in your model. Right? So the meteor parameters, they are not constant. They are variable, and you don't know how much they can vary. Yeah? So they can vary from minute to minute. Yeah? Yeah. And then you have another variable that's the rate of climb. Yeah, when in the climb and descent, each aircraft is climbing and descending, this you don't know, or it's very difficult to find out. Yeah? Then if to keep a separation of 5 nautical miles, yeah, you need a delay of 30 seconds. Yeah? Mm-hmm. How can you calculate 2 hours in advance with all these variables, mm-hmm. but the separation? They are going to be able to lose the separation.
We are thinking on the 4D contract. So there is the strategic level, we provide the strategic level, but we expect that the aircraft is following the 4D trajectory, and they will have a clearance from the ATC for 20 minutes time window, which is the 4D contract. Okay? If the user is inside the 4D contract, it was already deconflicted, because we are working not only with SBT but also with RBT. Okay, they are flying and we are reconfiguring the route, not only pre-departure. Okay, so but while they are flying, they have a 20-minute for the contract, and if they respect, there is no it should be no conflict in the network, in absence of other kind of uncertainties. Okay, but if the user deviate from the 4D contract, even in the spatial dimension or in the time dimension, then it is not respecting the contract. And if a conflict is generated because this user is deviating and not matching the contract, then the ATC should penalize this user, or may penalize this user, in order to, hey, you should speed up or change your trajectory because you are generating a conflict and you are not respecting the contract. This is a concept which is underlying in this strategic phase, because it is designing thinking also in the tactical phase. And this is the way, assuming that pilots will have 4D contacts and there is a 20 minutes time window to absorb certain deviations. And also in the strategic phase, we propose to further study what the ideal buffers from a strategic view. We saw that 10, 12 nautical miles could be a good trade-off, but we should further study that.
Anyway, this would be the part focusing on the RBT resolution, but we focused under the scope of stream in the SPT. That's why we focused on cruise phase, because it's the phase of the flight where you can have more reliable information in advance. So this would be just a further step in order to take on board information from the RBT in a tactical look ahead time.
Let me take another question.
Two questions I have, actually, two simple ones. The first one is, can you compare the results, the performance of your approach to that of Erasmus, which has a slightly different approach and slightly different conditions? Second one, the fuel burn figures that you showed, are those fuel burns per conflict or per aircraft?
Per aircraft.
Per aircraft, okay. So you have to multiply that by the number of aircraft and then divide by the number of conflict in order to go. That was around 5 kilo or so.
It's additional cost.
Yeah, of course. Yeah. And Erasmus?
Yeah, actually, Erasmus is, as far as we understood from the background studies, is applying differences of speed, mm-hmm. but in a more of a tactical look ahead time, mm-hmm. after takeoff of the aircraft. So, if we are considering the RBT, because this is a rolling nature of the concept of operation of stream solution, we are looking at we are capable of implementing SPT changes. But while we are considering a change in the SPT of one trajectory, we may be dealing with an RBT which is conflicting with this first trajectory. Because trajectories are in different stages of maturity, let's say. Mm-hmm. So if we are also considering this RBT, we can also implement in the algorithm different resolution strategies, because it's actually only about the resolution strategies. Mm-hmm. Under the scope of stream, the most exploited and explored strategy was the heading angle change, and then also flight level step changes. Mm-hmm. But we are capable of implementing different resolution strategies also in speed.
Can you compare the performance of your approach to that of
not right Erasmus? Now, because some my strategies of resolution strategies should be implemented. They are not already implemented, but it could be done. Mm-hmm. And also, we could take advantage of the concept of temporal looseness, so you can adjust your decision making according to the how many minutes you can advance or delay an aircraft without interacting with any other trajectory in the network. So, but a direct comparison could be done by implementing the resolution and strategies according to when you detect a conflict, instead of having a heading angle change, trying to apply a speed adjustment or a combination of too many hours. Mm-hmm. And also it could be further studied applying dynamic cost index. Mm-hmm. But when you change the route, you should theoretically, you may apply a different cost index because the route is not the same. So, but it is a lot of things that we could do, but we have the baseline, but they are not already implemented.
Okay. Also, this speed changes, it can also be put against the capability that the stream solutions showed of having temporal looseness analysis and see how this affects to the overall performance of the network. So you can compare how different resolution strategies are affecting with the metrics that we are measuring. So you can compare the differences in speed adjustments and the deviations or the delays applied to the trajectories. And it can be balanced.
Mm-hmm. So. Bear in mind that Work Package E is long-term exploratory research. Okay, we're not trying to develop something for implementation tomorrow. In terms of the uncertainty thing, it's been an issue from the beginning for Leila and myself, because the idea that you can have a rather precise idea of departure time is rather fantasy at the moment. So. But the project, we knew from the start that the project was taking a fairly simplistic view of that, based on taking the Cesar idea of 4D trajectories at face value, really, and working with that. But I don't think that invalidates many of the techniques that have been looked at. And it's been important, for example, to say, okay, you can take a macroscopic complexity-oriented view, which I think came out in one of the slides as well. So the whole idea of uncertainty and assuming that you have a precise departure time is an important point, but it shouldn't be something that distracts completely from the work that's been done in the project, in my point of view. Taylor has some questions.
I should clarify one thing. In your presentations, most of you guys associated free route airspace with direct routes, and in parentheses somewhere it was written that simplified version of free route. I should emphasize that there is an ongoing discussion about the free route airspace, and free route. I can say that free route airspace is not direct routing. And first, you should clarify this thing. And direct routing is right now is only in tactical phase, but for the future we are thinking of implementing new OIs as direct to direct routes as in strategic phase. But free route airspace is a thing that you define for step one, because you said that it's obvious that this project is futuristic and it will be maybe implemented in 20 years time, 30 years time, I don't know right now, but in CESAR step one, right now we are discussing in 7.5.3, pre-route is you define the entrance and exit points, and the airspace users will have the right to pick the entrance and exit points. And in that route, they can also identify intermediate points by them. Free route is that first. We should clarify this. It's not direct.
That's why I say that this is a simplification, the direct route, because in fact, to apply the concept of free route, you need to know the weather. You may want to use the jet streams to improve your trajectory and so on. You may choose your flight level in between flight levels, even, because we currently structure the airspace in discrete flight levels, but probably why not using an intermediate flight level? We simplify because introducing the weather and the concept of free route is quite complicated, but the conflict detection and the global optimization would be the almost the same, applying both direct route or free route. Because we, in the causal analysis, it doesn't matter if you are applying a waypoint or another waypoint. We only look for qualitative information. So you are solving a conflict by the left hand, for example, or the right hand, but doesn't matter what's the exact point waypoint you are using. So in the free route concept, you may use whatever trajectory while respecting the 4D restriction given by the network manager when detecting a certain conflict. So
just to conclude on this question, I mean, yes, the direct route was used here as a very specific example of what could happen in a free route. We understand that at the end, the user can choose the best route for them will be the most efficient, no, in terms of cost. Of course, we are not considering the meteorological aspects. No? At the end, a free route would be very far different from a direct route, because maybe the aircraft needs to adapt its performance of flight to the wind conditions, meteorological, etc. Okay. I agree that maybe we shouldn't not use the term free route. Just say, okay, this is a direct route example. That could be one specific example in a free route environment. Okay? And this is more or less, I think, the approach that has been following the project. Of course, at the end, regarding free route, I mean, we are not applying them. In this way, we are not addressing the aspect of obtaining information of the flight. We assume that we have information of that planned flight, you know, but in the free route environment, we are saying that we are only going to have 3 points, no? Two or maybe 3 points of that potential flight. In that environment, it could be difficult, you know, to do conflict detection, conflict resolution with this kind of tool. So at the end, it's more a matter of getting the information of what is going to be the flight that, I mean, the trajectory that this aircraft it is going to really fly in a free route environment. And I think this is something that maybe could be done with a model, very, very complex model with a lot of statistical information in order to predict the behavior.
Just one small point to add rationale for choosing the direct routing scenario. It was we took a real traffic scenario data. So in order to get spontaneous conflicts that appear from business intentions from the airspace users, we didn't want to take the structured and tactically affected scenario, like the real scenario that was actually flown. And we took from this the departure and arrival points and the times from the real scenario. So we took this information from the real situation from the peak day in 2011, and from that we generated the direct routes in order to get spontaneous conflicts that may appear in the network regardless what has been actually done to solve them. So this way we get away from the pollution of the actual intervention in this scenario, and that's why we simplified the direct routing concept, even if it's really far from free routing. We simplified it because that's
a specific
case. Yeah, it's a specific case. Yeah.
That's just us.
But what kind of constraints does the system impose? Flight level change or lateral solutions?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, you mean for the conflict resolution?
Yes, for the conflict resolution.
We expect the optimal flight plans from the users. Then we check for conflicts, and when we identify conflicts, conceptually, like given this conflict definition in space and time to the user, and ask them for each of the users related in the conflict, we ask
for different resolutions, trajectories, optimal for them, respecting that for the restriction, so the definition of the conflict. So I detect a conflict in a certain region, and I have the definition of the conflict in space and time, and I give the user this restriction. You cannot go in this area at that time. This is a restriction for the
airspace user.
Sí, yes, for the airline. So I give to the airline this 4D restriction, which is the definition of the conflict, and I ask them for new resolution trajectories with several strategies. For example, give me one solving this area. You have to go from the starting point to the end point, but crossing this no-go zone. Okay, this no-go for this zone. So give me several trial trajectories, resolution trajectories, one, for example, one for going by the left, one by the right, one applying a flight level step, and so on, several strategies. And once I have all the strategies, I put them all in the conflict detection module, in the spatial data structure, and I can observe, and I can perform a causal analysis taking advantage of this information. Then I can provide with several conflict-free scenarios according to the preferences of the users in each local level problem, because they will provide optimal resolutions with different restrictions.
So it can be a level change, it can be a lateral change.
Yeah, I ask for them, and I ask to the user, sort the trajectories by your preference. So my preference is go straight, because it's my original trajectory, it's the optimal one. I want to go straight. But the network manager say me, no, give me another trajectory without crossing this area, which is a no-go area, and give me a trajectory going by the left, another one by the right, another one by the top, by the down. Then sort these trajectories. I ask, for example, 20 trajectories. Resolution trajectories, and then sort these trajectories, because you will optimize your trajectory, but maybe you optimize better by the left than by the right. Then the user will give me those trajectories sorted according to their preferences, and in the causal analysis, it is taking into account all this information. Which conflict is solving each of the trajectories, and which is the preference of the user. And also we apply other metrics like the cost and so on in order to provide conflict-free solutions that are Pareto efficient, and at the end we have a lot of conflict-free solutions, and we applying metrics, global metrics, agreed by all the stakeholders, can be provided which one of the Pareto efficient solutions is the most preferred by the collective set of stakeholders.
We are talking about shared business trajectories. So we are discussing before the pre-flight information in a transparent way. So what we can provide the end user also, the feedback is, even if you prefer these trajectories, look at this. That's the reason why we decided according to equity or according to any one of these metrics, why somehow the network manager could impose this resolution instead of this other, but at shared business trajectory level.
But I read somewhere that a shared business trajectory in your reports can also have an effect on reference business trajectory. It can be a confliction between a shared business trajectory and reference between business trajectory. And also the system has some constraints for, if I'm not wrong, also for that reference business trajectory. Am I right?
Right.
So you are also dealing with the RBTs then, not SBTs only.
Yes, right. So sometimes even we allow, we could prioritize just changes in the shared business trajectories, but we allow in case we can obtain a better solution for all the stakeholders involved, I mean all the aerospace users involved in this conflict, that maybe it's better to change this reference business trajectory. We are talking about a look-ahead time of 20 minutes or higher, it depends, because shared business trajectories are injected and can generate a conflict, but later on, okay? So according to this time horizon, we could even decide if it provides better metrics, yes, better ones, changing this preference strategy instead of trying to introduce changes in several shared business strategies.
So we can compare the concept of operations is that we extend this action to SPTs, but it's not that we are not dealing with RPTs. The thing is that, as I said before,
it makes a contradiction.
Because there might be two trajectories conflicting or interacting, and one may become an RBT before the other becomes RBT as well. So you have to take this into account. It's just that the algorithm may integrate some in the future may integrate some different criteria in order not to affect trajectories that are actually RBTs.
The algorithm could take into account the RBTs in order to detect conflicts. But for resolving the conflicts, we can keep the RBTs as they are, not touch RBTs. This is the concept that the algorithm
okay, let's do one last question. Let's do one last question from Leila.
It's not a question. We discussed already when you started your project, and I understand the confusing question that you get here, because I think it's most because of your title. When you say it's strategic confliction, people think about ATC confliction, and here your activity is more about DCP. And complexity management. It's more than
yeah.
You are using maybe strategy for the conflict, the confliction, but you are not the conflicting or the airspace. You are just dealing with the SPT, using a strategy of rerouting, a small micro rerouting.
We are giving an additional tool for the DCB functions, considering conflicts. This is the calculation.
Yes.
And this is something that also this tool could be done as a strategic phase. We can move forward maybe to the tactical. So at the end, this is something that could give us some solutions. And now it's giving some questions, no? Regarding the comment from Colin. No, this you know, innovative research. No, at the end, okay.
Yes,
what we are obtaining now is maybe opening the box. Pandora box or which box, but in order to see if we can get some benefits from this concept.
This is the thing, I mean, it's good and bad that...
What could be the application of this kind of...
You had a two-stage project, and halfway through the project you came up with a whole new list of questions and orientations for the second half, and then at the end of the project we have even more questions or possibilities than we had at the beginning. So, but this is, I'm not criticising, I'm saying, you know, maybe that's a good thing. But I'm going to stop the discussion right there. If you want to continue, we'll go for lunch, and thank you for the presentation. It was...